Hello, Bee here, and welcome back to Biology. Today, we are going to delve into the world of biodiversity and look at theme 4, evolution. Any idea what biodiversity means? Well, it has the prefix bio, which usually means life or living, and diversity just means having a lot of different types of things. So biodiversity must mean all the different types of living things on Earth. In the last lesson, you saw lots of diversity when we looked at different types of biomes. How many different types of living things do you think you could find on Earth? 100? 1,000? 1 million? More? We'll find out what scientists say, but you can make your own guess. After today's lesson, you'll be able to describe the basic system of classification for living things and explain how evolution occurs, which is responsible for the vast amount of biodiversity on Earth. We'll also look at how common ancestors can help us piece together evolutionary relationships. Ready? Let's get started. So, how many different types of living things did you guess there are in the world? It might be easier to ask, how many different species are in the world? Do you know what a species is? This might seem like a strange definition, but it's a group of organisms capable of producing fertile offspring. This means that their kids have to be able to have kids. Let's take horses, for example. There are over 200 different breeds of domesticated horses. Quarter horse, Arabian, thoroughbred, just to name a few, but they are all the same species. This means they can all mate and have not only baby horses, but grandbaby horses too. But what if a horse were to have a baby with a donkey? It might seem odd, but it actually works. Their offspring is called a mule. But donkeys and horses are not the same species because their offspring, mules, can't have their own offspring. This means they are sterile. So the proud horse and donkey parents will never have grandchildren from the mule. This is what determines whether two organisms are part of the same species. Besides the official definition of needing to be able to produce fertile offspring, members of the same species typically share quite a few physical and behavioral characteristics too. Some examples of species that you're probably familiar with include chimpanzees, chickens, horseshoe crabs, ponderosa pine trees, and humans. But back to our question, how many different species are on Earth? Scientists estimate that there are about 8 million, and some scientists think that number might be even higher. Why don't they know for sure? Well, many species live in remote areas that are hard to study, so we only have an estimate. But is it more than you predicted? With 8 million different species to keep track of, how can scientists even begin to make sense of what's what? They had to come up with a system of classification and a way of grouping similar organisms in a manner that makes sense. Some of these groups you are already familiar with: plants, animals, fungi, and bacteria. But there's a little more to the story. The largest classification groups are called domains, and there are only three of them: eukarya, bacteria, and archaea. Most of the organisms you are familiar with, animals, plants, fungi, and protists, are in the domain eukarya. Each of these four groups makes up a kingdom. The archaea and bacteria domains have only one kingdom each and contain microscopic, single-celled organisms. Pause the video for a moment so that you can copy these groups into your notes. Why do these tiny, seemingly insignificant little creatures get two-thirds of the domains? We'll find out more about that later in the course. For now, just know that they exist. But what about us humans? Is there no group for us? We are living things. There is definitely a group for us within the animal kingdom because humans share a lot of characteristics with animals. That's why we have so much in common with some of our favorite furry friends. And that's a great excuse for a cute cat video. Our animal bond is strong. As humans, we might consider our species pretty important. We definitely have a big impact on this planet. But humans only make up 0.01% of the mass of living things on Earth. That's 1/10,000th. That means there must be a lot of biodiversity on Earth if we make up so little of it. And so far, the numbers we have talked about, 8 million species, only apply to organisms alive today. Scientists estimate that nearly 99% of species that ever lived have already gone extinct. That means if we count the entire history of Earth, it's so much biodiversity that our minds can hardly comprehend it. But why so many different types of living things? Why aren't all living things the same? Well, remember that Earth is home to many different biomes, and each biome has its own unique challenges that living things must overcome. At the very least, organisms must be able to find food, find shelter, and find mates. These challenges will require very different solutions depending on the exact environment an organism lives in. After all, surviving in the hot, arid desert would be very different from surviving in the Arctic Ocean. When an organism does inherit a useful trait that helps them solve one of these challenges, it is called an adaptation. An adaptation can be any trait that helps an organism survive and reproduce. An obvious example of an adaptation is a giraffe's long neck. Giraffes like to eat leaves that are way up in high trees. The longer their neck, the more likely they are to find food, and find it in places other animals can't reach. The more food they eat, the more likely they are to survive. Remember that the other part of the definition for adaptation was that it makes the organism more likely to reproduce. Well, the math is pretty simple here. If the giraffe lives long enough, there's a good chance they'll reproduce at some point, and hopefully pass on the trait of having that really long neck. If an unfortunate giraffe is born with a short neck, he'll probably starve to death long before he can reproduce and pass on that undesirable trait. It's a harsh world out there. When organisms which are better adapted to their environment produce offspring more successfully than those which are not, natural selection takes place. Because the adaptation which helps them survive and reproduce is an inherited trait, there is a good chance that it will be passed on to their offspring as well. This causes the next generations to become more and more adapted to their environment. This is also called fitness, or survival of the fittest. Remember that it only works for traits that can be inherited or passed down from their parents. Pause the video for a moment if you need to, and fill in the missing words on your notes here. The idea of natural selection explains why an individual population might become better at surviving in its environment. But how does it lead to the amount of biodiversity that we now know exists? The answer is all about time. Lots and lots and lots of time. Very small changes, unnoticeable on any scale of time that we are used to measuring, do add up over millions of years. Eventually, these changes become so dramatic that a whole new species has formed. Isolation makes this even more likely. If a group of individuals becomes isolated from the rest of the population, they will likely experience different challenges than the original group. This will lead to new adaptations. If enough time passes before they are reunited with the group, it's possible that the differences between them will have become so great that they won't even be the same species now. This is called speciation, the formation of a new species. Evolution is the gradual change of populations over time. It includes speciation, often through isolation and natural selection. But those are only some of the ways in which a population can change, and we'll talk about other changes later in the course. Because evolution involves very slow changes, most of which happened millions of years ago, how can we possibly study it to learn about the history of life on Earth? Good clues get left in the form of fossils. A fossil is any preserved remains of a once-living organism. It could be preserved bones or teeth, imprints of skin, or even footprints. Fossil evidence suggests that the earliest life forms evolved on Earth over 3 billion years ago. These would have been tiny microscopic organisms. Remember that they make up two of the three domains of life on Earth. Small but mighty, they fundamentally changed Earth's atmosphere by releasing oxygen and paved the way for bigger and more complicated organisms to evolve after them. With the help of fossils, we can study how different organisms are related to each other. If two species are closely related, this means that they share a recent common ancestor. In evolutionary terms, millions of years might be considered recent. At a much smaller scale, you are probably familiar with this idea if you have cousins. You share a common ancestor with them, your grandparents. Putting together evolutionary relationships is a lot like building a big family tree. Let's look at the giraffe again. What animal do you think it's most closely related to? Look at these options and make your best guess. Its closest living relative is the okapi. The giraffes and okapi share a common ancestor called acanthumerix. You've probably never heard of acanthumerix because they were extinct around 12 million years ago, but their legacy lives on in giraffes and okapis, which both evolved from them. Are giraffes related to other living organisms? Well, sure, just not as closely. For example, to find a common ancestor between a giraffe and a camel, we would have to go back almost 50 million years, and we would have to go back even farther to find a common ancestor between giraffes and horses. The farther back the common ancestor is, the less related the two organisms are. This is why your second cousins are less related to you than your first cousins. You have to go back another generation to your great-grandparents to find a common ancestor. But this family tree of life on Earth could go on and on. Let's recap what we've discovered today. We looked at the organization of life on Earth, that it's divided into three domains: eukarya, archaea, and bacteria. We discussed how adaptations and natural selection lead a population to become better suited to its environment. And we compared the evolutionary relationships of organisms based on a common ancestor. So, you've had just a taste of the vast amount of biodiversity that exists on Earth, and we've delved just a little into the processes that cause it. Next time, we'll take a look at biodiversity on a much smaller scale, the diversity that exists within a species, like humans. There's so much more to tell you about here, but you'll have that to look forward to later in the course. Until next time, remember, biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. Hey, hey.